Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I wish you all a very happy Independence Day. Dr. Gajan, can we start, sir?
My good wishes to all on the Independence Day. And now we can start. We have got a very learned speaker today, Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain, with us. And he will be speaking on a very, very important topic for the day. So, Dr. Sandeep, please go ahead.
So, good afternoon, everyone. So, today is the 74th Independence Day of India. And on this occasion, with the new norm of working, with the new norm of celebrating, we all have gathered together. And as the world confronts with a deadly virus, which has disrupted all our activities and taken a huge toll, let us rise to our national anthem.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladhi Taranga Tava Shubha Name Jage Tava Shubha Ashish Mage Gahe Tava Jaya Gatha Jana Gana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He
Thank you, sir. So, once again, I welcome you all for this 21st issue of our DigiConnect series. And this is a great learning for every one of us, how to connect with each other. Although the virus is still not under control, and a lot of happenings have been there in the across the globe. As on date, more than 2 crore total confirmed cases have been detected across the globe. And in India also, now more than 25 lakh cases are there. And daily we are making new highs in the new newly detected cases. More than 60,000 cases are detected per day in India, and we also number one in the death toll, which is being reported from India, and in the number of active cases also now we are second after United States of America. So lot of learnings will be there from this session. It is my proud privilege to welcome Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain. Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain is our Vice President of Association of Environment and Occupation in Delhi, that is IUS Delhi branch. And before I introduce him, I request Dr. Gajen Kumar to give the welcome address, sir. Dr. Gajen, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. I welcome you all to this series of our DigiConnect, which we are regularly having since this lockdown and the corona pandemic has come. So today it is all the more important because the situation in the country is grim, and on the contrary, there is complacency on part of everybody, be it the medical professional, be it the general public, be it the policy makers. They are all that fear of the virus is off. With the result, the level of precautions which we are supposed to take is now started missing. Even today from the Red Fort, when the Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister, was addressing the nation, I found so many Union Cabinet Ministers without mask. Or if they were wearing masks, it was below their nose. Wearing a mask below nose is as good as not wearing a mask. Rather, I would say, it is just like wearing a condom on the testicle for a safe sex. It is equivalent to that. So, things are not good, I tell you. And with the result, the daily number of cases increasing in the country is large, very large. And now we have jumped from the bottom position to number 2 in the world. So this is not a healthy sign. And on this situation, I think we have got a very good speaker, very learned speaker with us today. And I think we will learn a lot of things out of it. Thank you so much. Dr. Sandeep, please.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So as Dr. Gajend Kumar said, since last so many months, we have been under the pressure of controlling the virus, which is a new virus, and it is evolving day by day. The situation is evolving day by day. And from the situation which was there few months back, now the situation has completely changed, but still the things are not under control. And as rightly said by even our Honorable President of India today, that this invisible virus has demolished the illusion that human being is the master of the nature. And he said that it is still not too late for humanity to correlate and make the correction of its course and live in harmony with the nature. The world confronts a deadly virus which has disrupted all the activities and taken a huge toll. And even the Prime Minister of India, while giving his 74th Independence Day speech from the Red Fort, he said, expressed his gratitude to the coronavirus in his Independence Day speech today. And after hearing from our President of India, our Prime Minister of India, it's my proud privilege to listen to Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain on the whole situation which has evolved over the past so many months. And the topic of discussion today will be the Independence Day musings, looking back, looking forward. I think Dr. Rajiv Jain doesn't need much of introduction, but still it's my duty to say a few words about him, that he is our senior vice president from Association of Environment and Occupation in Delhi. He's a medical graduate from Maulana Azad Medical College, and he has done his DCH and MD in pediatrics. And he is a health administration, DNB in health administration, including hospital administration. And he has got so many laurels and so many degrees to his credit. And so such a vast experience. And right now he is senior consultant health with Indian Railways, New Delhi. He has got a 40 years of large, huge experience in the health and hospital administration, and has been awarded a lot of fellow awards in public health, in Association of Environment and Occupation Health, AEOHD, AICO, and he has written so many postgraduate theses. He has been postgraduate thesis assessor in hospital administration for All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and he has been awarded Golden Jubilee Oration and many other orations from different branches and even from the central IUH. And he has been director. Has been director of health and family welfare in the Ministry of Railways from 2006 to 2011, and member of the Project Advisory Committee of the People for Health Project of Public Health Foundation of India and European Commission. And he is ex-editor of the Journal of Academy of Hospital Administration. So such a learned faculty and such a person with a vast experience. And our own vice president, we thought that he will be the best person to guide us from the learning experience for last few months. And now the floor is yours, Dr. Rajiv Jain, sir. You can share your screen and start your presentation, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep and President AEOHD for the nice word that you've spoken. I don't know how much I deserve. All the same, let's get on with the proceedings of the day, where we will try to have a recap on three aspects, namely when we are celebrating 70 Fourth Independent Day, it is natural to do a recap of what India has forgotten, it seems. That is the sacrifice of countless freedom fighters who gave us this independent India. So in the first part of my talk, I will try to again remember some unsung heroes of our independence struggle. I start with Aluri Sitaram Raju from Vishakhapatnam United Rebels. He led the Rampa Rebellion in 1922 against the British rule. Karnat Sadashiva Rao from Karnataka, who gave his entire wealth and dedicated his life for the freedom struggle, and he died penniless. Dinesh Gupta, he was a revolutionary freedom fighter. In 1931, he was hanged in Alipur jail for attack on writer's building. Tamil revolutionary poet and writer Subban Bharti, in 1909, his magazine Vijaya was banned. Freedom fighter Tirupur Bumaran from Tirupur, where he died in police assault. Freedom fighter and socialist leader Acharya Narendra Dev, he was jailed several times during the freedom struggle. Bhai Permanand from Punjab was a prominent leader of the Gadar party. He was imprisoned in Andaman Cellular Jail for Lahore conspiracy case. Hazaribagh Central Jail, from where Jayaprakash Narayan escaped in 1942 by using 53 dhotis. Chandra Singh Garhwali, he refused to fire on Khudai Khidmat Gars in Kissa Khawani Bazaar in Peshawar. Bhagat Singh, these are few of his personal belongings, who laid his life. These are four brave freedom fighters who died in the cellular jail in Andaman. Mohan Kishore Namdas, Baba Bhan Singh, Indubhushan Ray, and Mohit Mohatra. Lakshmi Indira Panda, who was a soldier in Azadin Fauj. She worked as a household and cleaning utensils for living in Odisha. She joined INA in Burma, and she was denied pension for freedom fighters by the central government. And in 2008, she died in utter poverty. In 1938, Gadar party leaders under arrest at Amritsar railway station. Tara Rani Srivastava's husband was shot while marching to hoist the flag in C1, but she did not stop. She joined Quit India movement. Thakur Roshan Singh was hanged in Allahabad jail for Kakori conspiracy. Bina Das was member of the Chhatri Sangh, was imprisoned for 9 years for revolutionary activities. Lala Hardayal was leader of Gadar party. He was a polymath, world citizen. He devoted his life for freedom struggle. In 1908, revolutionary Khudiram Bose was hanged for Muzaffarpur bomb conspiracy. He was 19 years of age. 1943, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose forms the Provisional Government of Free India. This is a poster in Lahore to buy Swadeshi goods, and it says, India's pride nation's wealth. Which seems so contemporary today. Freedom fighter Shyamji Krishna Varma, he founded the Indian Humboldt Society in London. In America, Tarak Nath Das mobilized Indian immigrants for the freedom movement. Samuel Stokes, also known as Satyanand, was American national who participated in Indian freedom movement and was jailed for sedition. This house in Cuttack, where a secret meeting point of several stalwarts of the freedom struggle of India, the likes of Netaji, Subhash Chandra Bose, Bhagbati Charan Panigrahi, and several others. Now, an Odisha chief minister used to reside here. 19-year-old student Jain shot in Mandla, Madhya Pradesh, during the Quit India movement. In 1907, Banke Dayal from Gujranwala, editor of Chang Sial newspaper, he wrote, "Pagdi Samal Jatta, Pagdi Samal Hoye," song, and sang it in a rally at Lalpur. Song became so popular that Sardar Ajit Singh started Pagdi Samal Jatta movement, and Banke Dayal was exiled. So, warriors for freedom struggle and warriors for COVID. There is a continuity. When we look back at the freedom struggle, you would realize that it was long and tough battle. Similar is the battle against COVID. And the warriors take many shapes. Doctors, health workers, sanitation workers, security personnel, and the entire citizenship are the real warriors who, by their responsible citizenry, would ensure that this pandemic is not only controlled and further spread prevented, but also lays down standard for the life, a new life in the present and the near future. So to go to analyze the present, what I will do is, in few slides, I would show you the current epidemiological situation and in India, focusing on states. So let's start with this graph where blue shows the recovered patients and deaths are in red and active cases are in gray. What we find is today, as we started this journey from March end to till yesterday, we had almost reached, as Dr. Sandeep has told, we have reached the landmark 25 lakh cases. But that's not the real story. The real story is that a substantial number of patients having got affected with COVID have recovered. More than 71% have recovered. And only 27% are active cases, and deaths have been contained below 2%, which is a big achievement for India. Because if you see the deaths, whether in terms of cases or in terms of total population or in terms of infection, this is a very good number. That means Indian clinical management protocol is working. It also means that the cases are recovering to a substantial extent. But that is not the end of the story. Rather, that is the beginning of the story. In India, there are hotspots and there are number of hotspots. So we have to go deeper. This is slide which shows 8 cities in India, 8 states actually, Delhi, Maharashtra, Pune, and again, Maharashtra Thane and Maharashtra Mumbai are shown. Tamil Nadu Chennai is shown. Karnataka Bangalore Urban is shown. Andhra Pradesh Kurnool is shown. And Andhra Pradesh East Godavari is shown. These are 4 distinct categories of cities in our country. And that is going to happen and continue to happen in the next few months, maybe years. If you see in Delhi, 89% of cases have recovered and only 7% are active cases. But in Thane, Mumbai and Pune, the cases are substantially high, and also the recovery rate is below 80%. In Bangalore Urban, the situation is worse. Recovery rate is only 57.8%. If you look at the blue, 57%, active case is 40%. In Andhra Pradesh Kurnool, 68% recovery, 30% active cases. East Godavari district, 56% recovered cases, 42% active cases. So if we go deeper and deeper into smaller cities and have similar graphs, we will find the situation is just started in terms of cases and recoveries. So this is a long battle, like freedom struggle. The entire India has to work together like they worked during the freedom struggle and continue to struggle and do not hope to be victorious till the entire country becomes victorious. Another good thing which happened in India was the rate of samples which were being collected. Our testing capacity, our rate of testing in the entire country has gone up to 8 lakh tests per day, which is a huge increase from the point that we started. Our Prime Minister also mentioned in his speech today from Bradford. And we are targeting in the next 10 days, we're going to touch 10 lakh tests per day. That's a big, big effort like we did during the freedom struggle. This is a graph which shows deaths per million and the positivity rate. Positivity rate is on the x-axis, and on the y-axis we have deaths per million. But what you see here, quite huge diversity amongst the states in our country. If you see, Maharashtra is on the right top and Himachal Pradesh and Arunachal at the bottom left, which means huge disparities and inequity in terms of positivity rates and the deaths per million, if we correlate that two. Unless we do substantial testing, the test positivity rate cannot come down below 5%, which is an indicator of good testing capacity. And how would you test? You would test people as per the ICMR criteria. For that, you require to test all the individuals who have been in high-risk contact with the positive cases. And also, containment zone definition, defining specific parameters for containment zone, and allowing to be tested all those who have symptoms. all across the country. Case fatality rate, of course, you've seen how it has come down substantially over a period of time. And if you look at this, this is the global rate, global case fatality, and this is the Indian case fatality. So we have been able to manage in terms of cases. Our clinical management has been very up to the mark, very much up to the mark, as well as it betters the global standards. Average growth rate of active cases, if you see per lockdown, lockdown one was very high, lockdown two, it came down, lockdown three, it came further down, and four, it came further down, and post lockdown, unlockdown, you are seeing now the stabilization and also further downward trend in average growth rate in active cases. So this at the pan-India level is a good story, but if we go deeper into states, we find quite huge disparities. This is our country shown through different states, and India is on the left top. Karnataka, if you see, is going up and up in new cases. Bihar is also going up. Rajasthan is also stabilizing and going up. Kerala is still coming up. It's still not reached the top. Karnataka again is there. Maharashtra is still going up and up. And Delhi, fortunately, has come down, but we do not know. This is going to remain at this level or again go up in the second upsurge. So we are not sure, but it has been contained till today. And it is now plateauing at the bottom, but yet not reached the down bottom in Delhi. Telangana state is again going in the up. It is in the still plateau phase at the moment. It may go up as well, but it is at the high plateau. Then we have Odisha. Punjab is also again going up. If you see here, it's going up and up. Uttarakhand again is going through different phases. Tamil Nadu is still going up and maintaining the plateau at the top. Uttar Pradesh is going up and up, and further districts are getting affected. Gujarat is still at the top plateau. There is no sign of coming down in new cases. Haryana is still plateauing at the top. Jammu Kashmir is also plateauing at the top. Andhra Pradesh still plateauing at the top. West Bengal is still going up and up. No sign of a plateau. Madhya Pradesh is still plateauing. And there's no sign of downward trend in these. Jharkhand is again plateauing. So all across the country, we are seeing trends in terms of growth in number of new cases. This is a 7-day moving average. So we need to be on guard in terms of active cases growth and in terms of new regions getting affected, new districts getting affected, new towns getting affected, new villages getting affected. And this will go on for many, many months in our country. Why so? This is sheer geographical spread. Our continent is like Europe, but the rate of movement of people is slower than in Europe. So what we're going to see, a long protracted battle like an independence struggle. It'll be a long, hard battle for which we all need to be prepared all across the country. This is the same graph which I've shown earlier. Now, another good way of knowing what we are doing and how we are doing and are we doing enough is to know as to how much states are testing. Total tests and test positivity rate is a good indicator if we plot it over time. to know what we are doing and to contain the spread of what we are doing to prevent further spread, and are we effective or do we need to do more? So if you see here, if you look at this, this is left top is Uttar Pradesh. This is test positivity rate on the y-axis, and x-axis the total number of tested. So ratio of positive cases to overall tested. So what you find here, it is going up, positivity rate is going up. Tests are not sufficient even today. Tamil Nadu test needs to go up substantially. Maharashtra test are still required, because the simple reason that positivity rate has to come down to 5% of the tested, and we should be testing substantial numbers. Andhra Pradesh total tested are 27,05,000, and total positivity rate you are seeing, it is still going up more than 7.5%. Karnataka is more than 12.5% and total 18 lakh tested. Rajasthan total more than around 3% are there, total 18 lakh. Assam, Bihar, the story is similar. All across the country, if you see 5% positivity rate, very few cities have still achieved. Even where the 5% positivity rate has been achieved, the number of tests is not sufficient. So we need to do substantially more testing, and also ensure that right kind of individuals are tested. And we have to maintain this testing criteria. Another interesting story is now opening up in northeastern states, where this is a graph for the entire northeastern state, 8 states at the moment. And this data is of August 12. Assam, 15 lakh tested, 68,000 positive, test positivity rate is coming to be 5%. But they need to test more. Tripura, test positivity rate is around 3%. They need to test more. Arunachal Pradesh, 2% test positivity rate. Manipur, 3% positivity rate. Nagaland, 6% positivity rate. Meghalaya, 3% positivity rate. Sikkim, 3% positivity rate, and patchy data is there. Mizoram is around 2.5% positivity rate. But if you see their graphs, it is not going up substantially. The gradient of the graph is not going substantially up, because the number of tests have not increased the way they should have increased. So they have to substantially do more testing. This also shows India's disparity in terms of healthcare inequity and in terms of COVID death rate range. This is COVID death rate per million. If you see at the bottom, it is Delhi. And the last is August 13 date. The purple dot here on the extreme right bottom is 222.7. And Sikkim is 1.45. So see the range of COVID death rate per million in India. So this itself will show you how much effort need to be put in over a long period of time to be able to see that this trend, instead of being a curve downhill, is a vertical . Because only then we will have clinical protocol being followed all across the country uniformly. Otherwise, health access will remain, health equity will remain an issue, health access will remain an issue, as is visible in this slide. People across wealth classes go to public health facilities when they work, but when they don't work, few across wealth classes go there. So it is a misconception that rich go to private health facilities and poor to public health facilities. Like, look at this. This is percent distribution of households that generally go for treatment to public health care by wealth class. Kerala, the poorest are going and richest are going to private. 52% are going to public health care facility. In Tamil Nadu, richest, only 30% are going to public health facility. Richest are going 30% and poorest are 90% to public health facility. In Bihar, if you see 23% to 13% is the range where people use the public health facility. In Uttar Pradesh, 21 and 18, all across, the use rate of public health facilities is very, very low. This is the range of challenge and the diversity of challenge that we have in our country. And it will reflect in our COVID death rate. It will reflect in our testing capacity. It is going to reflect in our COVID management. Because only when we test, we know where are the positive people. Only when we test, we will isolate and we will institute early treatment facility, including SpO2 measurement and definitive treatment if the treatment is required for moderate and severe cases in a hospital facility, provided the hospitals are situated, accessible and affordable. So this challenge will determine the outcome of COVID in our country. But this we have been talking about COVID as it is happening. But another story is unraveling in India, that is the world of work. The world of work has changed. Most of the organizations are shifting to teleworking and telecommuting. The people who are healthy have to change the way they work and the place they work from. And it is going to be also for long haul. It is not going to be for short period. So when we consider the requirement of occupational health and safety at the workplace, the entire operational area of occupational health physicians need to change from workplace, because the workplace has shifted. So it has to shift to homes, because homes are the places where most of the working is getting shifted to. So new speciality of teleworking occupational safety and health professionals has to evolve in the days and months and years to come. What these professionals and what area of work and effectiveness they go to roll out in the years to come shall determine the resilience of mankind, not only in India but across the world. One has to remember there has been abrupt shift involving a large number of organizations from office-based working to telework, and this happened without much consideration to health and safety requirements which would otherwise apply at the premises of the employer with clear roles and responsibilities to ensure the physical and mental well-being of employees. However, the physical and environmental characteristics of the home office and related work habits are critical to the worker's capability to perform remotely and effectively. This is very crucial if we have to manage the new normal. The new normal is teleworking, and teleworking is the new normal. According to most national laws and collective agreements regarding occupational safety and health, the employer is responsible for the protection of the occupational health and safety of workers. And this typically applies to teleworking as well. But does the employer realize that he is responsible for occupational health and safety at work? At work means at when the employee is working from home. Employers have the same health and safety responsibility for home-based teleworkers as for any other workers in the organization. These include identifying and managing the occupational risks of home-based teleworkers. In terms of occupational safety and health issues for teleworkers, besides the known benefits to workers' well-being, the two most commonly recognized challenges are psychosocial risks and ergonomics. Are we prepared? Do we know enough? No, we do know enough. Because this abrupt change, no employer, no occupational safety and health professional was prepared for this. So we have to learn, relearn, and keep evolving in the days and years to come. Working from home during COVID-19 pandemic, unlike teleworking under normal conditions, as workers are working from home for a prolonged period under difficult external circumstances, this situation itself is provoking higher levels of anxiety than usual in workers, which is linked with anxiety due to the health, social, and economic implications of the pandemic crisis. So two crises together is a huge challenge for mankind, for any worker, for any human being. According to the Eurofonds found survey launched on 9th April in this year, 18% of European Union respondents said they felt particularly tense most of the time over the past 2 weeks. This contrasts with just 11% in the 2016 survey. So from 11% to 18%, which is more than 80% increase in terms of people who had experienced anxiety. The ensuing stress and worry from COVID-19 pandemic have negatively affected mental health for close to half of the United States adults, a Kaiser Family Foundation survey revealed. I've given the reference at the bottom. More than 2/3 of American workers say this pandemic has resulted in the most stressful time of their careers, according to a poll by the mental health provider Ginger, and 88% said they were moderately to severely, extremely stressed during the previous 4 to 6 weeks. This is emerging evidence that things are going to be worse than they were earlier, and it is going to persist for a long time to come. According to the literature review of the Lancet Medical Journal, studies that surveyed those who had been quarantined during the pandemic reported depression, stress, low mood, irritability, insomnia, post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms, anger, emotional exhaustion as a result of being isolated or quarantined. This is substantial evidence, and there will be huge number who will be isolated or quarantined in the days and months to come, especially in India. The largest number of people who would be isolated or quarantined in the months and days to come will be in India. Low mood and irritability stand out as having a particularly high prevalence. Are we prepared to tackle these new normal situations in the workers and in the population at large? The numbers are huge. Do we have the capacity to tackle this situation? This is another epidemic in the making over the existing COVID-19 pandemic. Another survey done on 5th of May revealed that technologists anonymously polled about their experiences. It found 73% of respondents were reporting burnout at the end of April, which is far above the 61% who felt exhaustion in the month of February. So this is what happened in USA, because they had the infection earlier. So February to April, from 61% to 73%. Some 19% of respondents said fears over their job security were at the root of their burnout, while slightly more, that is 20.5%, said that they had an unmanageable workload. If you see fear over job security and unmanageable workload, there are two range of responses, that challenges that individuals are facing today. Another 10% said that they felt they had no control over their work. losing control over their work, unmanageable workload, and fear over job security. These three challenges are huge challenges, and they are not going to go away in the months. It may take years for things to normalize. And the new normal may never be the normal of the past. So let us all face the reality and let us prepare for the new normal for the future. When we talk of telecommuting and teleworking, we also tend to overweigh and overemphasize the advantages like working condition, dress, entertainment, convenience, smoking, safety, view, cost savings, commuting saving, distraction at work, childcare, family, novelty, household chores, stress at work, autonomy, promotability, office politics, time for other activity, and access to information found at home, and flexibility. These are huge advantages. But do we also know the disadvantages of teleworking, telecommuting, and telework? Disadvantages of isolation, distraction at home, promotability, access to information at the office, training and development, boundary permeability, informal communication, professional image, working conditions at home, feedback, overeating, household chores, technology, trust, and flexibility. And though the number may be less in terms of disadvantages, but the quantum of these disadvantages is huge and mostly are of chronic nature. And this is not a temporary situation. This is for long haul. So we should prepare and prepare well based on the science of occupational safety and health. Employers, workers, and occupational safety and health professionals, they need to be aware of the associated risks of full-time telecommuting, which are accentuated by the COVID-19 pandemic and the resulting requirement for physical distancing. Techno stress and technology addiction and overload, it increases fatigue, irritability, and inability to switch off from work and rest properly. Increased consumption of alcohol and other recreational or performance-enhancing drugs, which may increase negative emotions, lower performance, and contribute to an increase in aggression and violence. Prolonged sedentary behavior, working in one position over long periods without moving, increases the risk of health problems, including musculoskeletal disorders, visual fatigue, obesity, heart diseases, and other problems. The ergonomics of home furniture may not be optimal for prolonged teleworking. Employers should therefore inform workers about key ergonomic issues, including via training. These preventive measures support workers to be able to adjust their working arrangements and change them if necessary. The responsibility for the right ergonomics in order to prevent musculoskeletal disorders should be shared by employers and workers. Are we sharing this? We need to examine this. Due to prolonged isolation, there is a risk of burnout and feeling left out, which requires an additional effort from employers, HR professionals, direct supervisors, and colleagues to extend mutual support. Is it happening? Slow or patchy internet and technology tools can also cause frustration and irritability. Therefore, proper, well-functioning tools for teleworkers should be ensured. Work-life conflict and the challenges related to managing the boundaries between working time and personal obligations are exacerbated, including an inability to switch off from work and recharge. This is especially the case for those with care responsibilities, such as parents with school-aged children at home. While part-time and occasional teleworking may reduce forms of violence and harassment requiring face-to-face contact, full-time and generalized teleworking arrangement may lead to a higher risk of technology-enabled violence, cyberbullying, and harassment, including domestic violence. And it is happening, and it is happening in India as well. And the incidence is increasing day by day all across our country. Increasing evidence is available all across the country for this. Occupational safety and health measures should be further strengthened to prevent and reduce psychosocial risks from this situation, including violence and harassment, and actively promote workers' mental health and well-being. This is what ILO has said in one of the documents, which is titled Managing Work-Related Psychosocial Risks During COVID-19 Pandemic. It is released in June this year. So, we as occupational safety and health professionals need to identify and work upon certain specific methods, certain specific strategy, certain specific action plan to ensure that the handshake between employers and employees happens more effectively, is more sustained, and is more efficiently implemented. So in this context, I have given about 7-8 recommendations. First and foremost is to clarify and update the responsibilities of employers for the protection of the occupational health and safety of the teleworker by taking stock of the health and safety risks and hazards, the home office environment, equipment, ergonomics, and stress, as well as other mental health issues. Second, clarify the rights and responsibilities of teleworkers regarding their health and safety while working from home. Third, update and empower health and safety professionals with tools and processes in terms of workers' health support systems, the working environment, training, information and compliance mechanism regarding occupational safety and health, and ergonomic protocols specifically designed for teleworkers. Fourth, train the managers and teleworkers on the importance of taking sufficient rest breaks during the workday, as well as clarifying that such breaks won't have negative career consequences. Fifth, use every opportunity to promote physical health, including exercise, and encourage workers to maintain healthy eating habits. That is, by sharing links to physical and mental well-being videos and promoting the use of fitness applications and services. Sixth, establish new options or augment existing options for psychological support for workers to share their fears and worries confidentially. That is, through access to helplines, counseling, employee assistance programs. Seventh, encourage managers to be a role model for staff under their supervision and conduct themselves in ways that show how to mitigate stress. Eight, consider allowing workers to borrow equipment from the office for the duration of the pandemic-related teleworking, such as office chairs, monitors, and other relevant tools that are fully compatible with ergonomic standards. These are few recommendations at the moment, but this can be further expanded, and the strategy for implementing this all across our country may be mapped out by AEOHD, AEOH, and we should be able to collaborate with ICO and ILO to further expand on this area. And it is crucial that this becomes a science for occupational safety and health professionals, and a science which is implementable and which is relevant to the situation at the moment and in the days and months and years to come. These are two slides I've given where tips for remote working I've given. Cyber security is first and foremost. The devices are for your professional use. Do not share them with your family and friends. Make sure that you lock them and turn them off when you are no longer using them. connect to a secure Wi-Fi network, and always work with network documents. Organization, plan your work and don't leave the most complex task until end. Distribute your time and avoid distractions. Once you start your activity, try not to stop halfway. Keep moving. Take short active pauses that allow you to alternate sitting with standing. This will also help you change the perspective of your vision and avoid eye fatigue. Workstation, choose a specific separate and quiet place. Routines, avoid working in your pajamas and keep temptations at bay. Fridge, smoking and coffee. Do some stretching exercise, especially your arms and neck, before starting work. Make calls that allow you to connect with your colleagues and not feel isolated. These are the four tips on how to telework in comfort and security. Number one, set aside a dedicated space for work that is ideally calm and bright. Second, manage your workspace ergonomics using the resources you have available. Third, ensure your comfort and safety. Use headphones, be careful of electric wires. Number four, move regularly to stay energized. So this, in nutshell, are the three areas which I wanted to focus. The struggle of independence and the battle with COVID are very similar. And we have to sustain the dedication that our fathers and forefathers have shown during independence struggle has to be shown during the pandemic, because it is going to be a long pandemic. It's not going to be 1 or 2 years pandemic. If you are reminded of 1918-1919 pandemic, again, you must remember it started in 1914. 5 years it went on. So this pandemic may also be very, very prolonged in spite of the vaccine maybe coming next year. Because the vaccine is at the most 60% efficacious. The vaccine, if available to be accessible all across the world, will take time. It will not be available to 100% of the population. It will be in the first phase will be available to only 3% of the population of any country. Next, it will be available to 10% of the population. Next, it will be available to 30% of the population. And the vaccine would be 60% efficacious. So that will never be a solution. So combination of occupational safety and health for telework, that is WFH, and good epidemiological pace, along with very robust, deep-rooted testing network and a good healthcare system, which is available even at home and at hospital and healthcare centers, that is the only solution. Unfortunately, today, our Prime Minister announced the digital health framework. This is a mission now. So the government is starting the framework. We need to ensure the content is supported on the digital health mission, and we are able to achieve this process of freedom again. But this freedom will be from COVID and freedom from all the diseases and disorders that we suffer due to teleworking. Thank you so much. Once again, Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. This was a very great and enthralling presentation by you on this 74th Independence Day, to correlate the struggle which we had during the independence period and the struggle which we, how it correlated with the struggle which we are having now today during the COVID times. Now, may I request our secretary to open the discussion and just unmute all the panelists and rest of the participants. They can just put their questions in the Q&A chat, and we'll have a good discussion after this enthralling presentation with Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain. Wherever there are some doubts, that can be cleared. So you all can ask your questions. All panelists can ask their questions one by one.
First of all, I compliment Dr. Rajiv for such a beautiful presentation. And beside this COVID presentation, the history of Indian independence, the unknown faces you have brought on, it was excellent and great appreciation for that. Number one, things are not that simple as it looks, and but you have raised, I mean, you have covered almost all the points which are important as far as this pandemic is concerned. I got two important questions. Number one, is there any study which shows that people, those has been infected with the virus and they have developed the immunity, the IgG, are these level are dwindling very fast or they will sustain for long? This is one. Because probably I learned that in China, they have seen that the IgG level, they come down after 4 months. Almost 4 months. And one observation, I don't agree with your one statement that alcohol consumption while at working from home has increased. In fact, it must have decreased because wives never allow you to drink. Okay.
Now it, well, very, very relevant constraint you told about. But wives, I think the new normal wives would be more accommodative.
Yeah, that is not relevant to me.
They have sympathy for the men. But on a serious note, the antibodies, all the studies that have come out have shown inconsistent rise of antibodies and inconsistent persistence of antibodies. The latest, which you must have noticed yesterday, USA. 3 months is the normal time that they persist in on average, but then they start dwindling down. So we do not know what is going to happen after 3 months. So the susceptibility may again be there. And another factor which we still do not know, this virus has not gone through the whole cycle of 1 year. Normally, if you see in the flu virus, the genetic shift also happens over a period of time. And that is directly proportional to challenges for its survival and growth. So that may also be a confounding factor. We do not know. But at the moment, the antibodies normally remain for 3 months and then they start going down.
In that case, that is the current. In that case, even if the vaccine comes in, that means repeated boosters will be required.
Maybe. In fact, the vaccine, if you see, the certain few vaccines are experimenting with 2 doses and some vaccines with 1 dose. That again will be a challenge as to what be the frequency, whether triple dose, 2 dose, and what be the gap between first and second and second and third. So that is still under examination at the moment. Number of studies are under process at the moment and globally.
Thank you.
The floor is open for questions.
Sandeep, may I say something?
Yeah, ma'am. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Dr. Jain, you kept
up. Yes, absolutely. Rajiv, I'm not able to see your face, actually.
What we expected from you was what you presented from old to new and the future. You're looking at vaccines. Very well thought out. Very good points. We appreciate what you have given.
Thank you so much.
But with all this, what all we have to take care and what all to be done, the next point is what is going to be our future? People 20, 30 plus who have just started their career in life, people 60 plus who are going to a second phase of their life. So what would be the next step for them to take? What would you say?
I'm very optimistic, actually. If you see in the past as well, and it's always good to look in the past, the big depression in US 20s, 1920s, the toughest generation comes after severe stress. So this generation who have experienced this pandemic will be a very tough generation. They'll be very robust, and they will add on to huge GDP all across the world. And that is what the past evidence has shown, and that is going to happen this time as well. If you see, the numbers of deaths have happened the maximum in most developed countries. This shock itself will give rise to a very robust Europe and America. So that the societies which had become so-called complacent are going to rise again. So this is going to be the new normal as well, I must say.
Thank you. We're looking forward to a better 2021.
Yeah, sure, ma'am. Dr. Shanbagh, sir, if you...
Yeah, Rajiv, excellent presentation always.
Thank you.
There's no question about your knowledge and your presentation. I was only wondering...
You're not audible now. Dr. Shanbagh, you're not audible. I'm not able to hear. I'm not able to hear what Dr. Shanbagh is saying.
He's not audible. He's not audible.
Anyway, for the time being, we can request Dr. Rajgopal or Dr. Shyam Pingle, sir. Dr. Rajgopal, sir.
Yeah, hi, Rajiv. It has been a wonderful disposition as usual and enriched a Saturday afternoon. And for a change, I'm going to call you a mentor and not a tormentor. Yeah. And my question to you is, you know, if you observe what is happening in Europe, there's a second wave which you can see. All the countries which opened up, they are facing a huge problem. But paradoxically, we are not finding a run on the hospitals, yeah, like we had in the first wave. Everything was just, you were not able to get any space in the hospital, ICU beds and all. Do you actually see a shift in terms of the virulence of this virus? What is happening? What would be your you know, considered views on this?
I feel the current wave in Europe also reflects the learnings and practice of those learnings from the first phase, which was very virulent phase or very fast phase. They have learned how to manage and how to isolate and effective ways of isolation. And one country, for example, in Germany, if you see, the cases have again risen, almost 1,000 cases every day now. There again, the if you look at the micro level, these are very small foci where the cause for spread of the virus is being tracked down very fast, which did not happen earlier. In most of the countries, like in Spain as well, the detection was not circumscribed so fast as is being done now. Italy, Spain, and Germany are three examples where circumscribing the infection and its origin fast has been a game changer in this phase than in the first phase. I think that is the reason. About virulence, we need to gather more evidence, and in the days and months to come, we will know more. And that will also help us in actually developing a vaccine as well. Because this is not a simple virus, we know very little. And also, we have to again remember, as some people were earlier saying, this virus has yet to see first winter of its life, as far as human being is concerned. This virus has not seen its first winter. So the winter of Europe, winter of US, winter of India will roll out another phase of our learning. That is what I feel now.
Thanks,
but summer is at the moment in Europe.
Yeah. So thanks, Dr. Jain. That was a very good reasoning of what is happening there. And if I might just ask you one more query. We see something paradoxical happening in Africa. you know, especially in places like Kenya and other places where we are really worried about what would happen if it takes root in Africa. Nothing seems to be happening there. Why? What is the reason? What do you feel?
I'm rather
How are the
scared.
Africans protected?
I'm rather scared of Africa. Because of the, if you see the African continent, very diverse countries with very fragile governance systems exist in Africa. The best robust health system in Africa is only in South Africa, where the evidence is that it is substantially present. If you go to West Africa and East Africa, quite diverse incidents. We do not know the real epidemiological situation or infection rate and its evolution in many, many African countries till date because of sheer lack of capacity in terms of testing, in terms of their ability to actually have a robust testing strategy, and also in terms of investing in capacity building in this short period of time because of the poor and fragile governance systems, including healthcare systems. Like you mentioned Kenya, if you go to Nairobi, you can realize the non-access to substantial areas in Nairobi itself, where the capital is situated. Leave aside the hinterland in Kenya, which is at times not even accessible. And there are cultural issues against non-testing, cultural issues against hygiene and governance effectiveness. Law enforcement agencies are still not that effective as they are effective in Europe or even in India at times. Many of the cities, we have very robust security infrastructure in place. And governance and democratic systems are very strong in India.
Thank you.
Yeah, Sandeep, can I speak? Yes, because I think there were some network issues and I got disconnected.
Yes, yes.
No, what my discussion with Rajiv was, I hope I am audible now.
Of course, yeah. Of course you are.
You see, I agree with you when you say that the employer will be responsible for providing the occupational health services when people work from home. But the challenge is going to be today when you have a medical center in your place of work, there is a captive audience and people can access and whatever you want to do. And when people are scattered all around, I think it's going to be a huge challenge for the occupational health physician to really provide occupational health services. That is number one. Number two, the whole issue is we were taught in medical colleges that unless you examine a patient, instead of providing remote consultations, unless you examine, neither the patient is happy nor you are happy with this. So I personally feel it may be a few months to a few years, but I think we'll have to come back to this present normal sometime. The present normal means before the COVID normal, whatever was there, we'll have to come back sometime. Whether it was Spanish flu, whether it's plague, whether it is we have come back to normal. I'm sure we'll come back more stronger, like what you really said, after this huge amount of stress which you are undergoing today. But I think there is no choice, but people have to come back to this old normal. This new normal is going to be there for a short while, as far as I am concerned. I think, people, even now, if you see once the lockdown, we went through 3-4 months of lockdown. If you see people's behavior now, they have started accepting COVID. People are moving around like as if it is, it's easy for them. So the human behavior, I think, will change. People accept COVID and everything will come back to normal. It might take a few months or maybe a few years. This is what my feeling is. And that's why I said, let me bounce it off you to find out what your views are on this.
Yes, it's very interesting, actually. But the problem in India is twofold. And that is a sheer neglect of the formalization of the job scenario in our country. And that was reflected in the crisis created by the migrant. Did we know about these migrants, where these migrants are, from which state they are, which organization they work? It is because of the simple fact in India, 92% work in the unorganized sector. Within the organized sector, 8% only 4%, that is 50% of the organized sector have access to occupational, organized occupational health professionals. We do not have a qualified postgraduate degree holder in occupational health in our country, because there is no postgraduate degree in occupational health in our country. So the occupational health professionals who are practicing in organized sector, large organizations, cater to only 4%. 96% either, even in large organized sector, do not have access to occupational health services. And that itself is now being tackled by Parliament. If you were tracking the Occupational Safety and Health Code, it is being fast-tracked, because the government was compelled to fast-track it because of sheer crisis that was created during the migrant crisis. The acuteness of need for having occupational safety and health for workers all across the country, including workers in the unorganized sector and in the gig economy, was highlighted. And the people's representatives, that is the legislatures in states and the center, are now seized of the matter, which is a great opportunity for the profession of occupational safety and health. Because now the new normal would be a requirement through statute, through supportive laws and financial mechanism to back them, to have access to occupational safety and health services to the workers, irrespective of the place where they are situated, whether in the organized sector or the unorganized sector, or whether in the gig economy or the conventional organized sector economy. And more formalization of work will happen faster than we have thought ever in India in the past. So it will be a boon to organized jobs, organized sector work, and access to more robust healthcare support systems, including occupational health services. That's what my, and new normal, of course, and this can, new normal cannot remain, but what I visualize, the shift to normal, that is a pre-COVID normal, and the new normal will be very slow and gradual. It will not be abrupt.
I would like to comment on at this point. Dr. Shanbhag was very right to say we will be back to pre-normal, I mean the pre-COVID era, very fast. I give you a very live example. In the month of June, when the virus was at the peak and there was lockdown, there was a lot of fear psychosis among the people. Even in my hospital, which is a 1416-bedded hospital, Central Hospital Railway in Connaught Place, Delhi, we started telemedicine services. And the average consultation per doctor per day was about 10 to 15 patients. In the July, it has reduced. And now in August, practically nobody is consulting on tele system. Everybody is physically coming to the hospital. There is no fear. And we are repeatedly telling them not to come to the hospital for routine checkup and routine work, because there is a facility of telemedicine. But now they just don't bother about it. Everybody is physically coming, because that element of healing touch of doctor, one-to-one connect with the doctor, that is very important as far as patient care is concerned. And that is the reason I am sure very soon we'll be back to pre-COVID era, whether Corona is there or COVID is there or no there, we will be back. And this we could see today at the Red Fort, while the Union Cabinet ministers were not wearing masks properly. See, because there is no fear, as simple as that. So this is my observation.
And again, on the contract labor or the unorganized sector, which you are talking about, there was a big knee-jerk reaction. People wanted to go to their near and dear ones. Everybody went. But if you see the present situation, if you ask the people in industry, all of the people who are left have started coming back. People are coming back for their old jobs, whether it is contract labor, whether it is the unorganized sector. People are coming back and work has started back, and even the industries are taking them back. So the whole issue is that there was an immediate knee-jerk reaction that they wanted to, you know, the fear, which Dr. Gajendra said just now, took them to say, let me go back to my near and dear ones. So they went there. But now after going there, with no job, no money, they have realized that they have to come back to work. And people have started coming back. So my personal view is that, you know, this will, I mean, I agree with you that, you know, people who have understood the namaste is going to stay. People may not, you know, hug you, but normal people will start working. And I agree with Gajendra, you know, this particular thing, the examination, the healing touch, the one-to-one contact, the one-to-one speaking, the counseling is going to make a lot of difference. Counseling on the phone is not like the normal counseling which happens.
Absolutely.
So I personally am of the opinion, very strong opinion, maybe 2021 early, maybe late 2021, everybody is going to slowly come back to normal, whether corona is there or not there.
Absolutely.
This is what I believe. I don't know if anybody else has got some other views.
Shanbhag, just to add on to what you said, you know, we are all social creatures. We just cannot continue like this, you know.
Yeah.
I cannot stay away from Jain for long. Let me just put it that way. I have to meet you physically, and also Sandeep and everyone else on this. So we are basically, you know, geared towards being a social animal. Everybody talks about the new normal, that people will continue working from home. I bet nobody will do that. Working from home is a crazy, crazy stuff. In fact, when we return to offices, one of the things which we tell our people across Unilever is, if you are feeling fatigued because you're working from home and because you are mentally not feeling good up to it, then even if you are vulnerable, we will try and help you as much as possible. But you want to come back, you know, we will see how best we can get you back. So this cannot continue indefinitely. And we are just waiting for the day when the vaccine comes and we have at least some hope that, you know, we would be able to get out of this. So I fully second what both Gajendra and Shanbhag are telling.
Yeah. Well, let's examine the unlocking, how fast it happens and how it rolls out in the interiors of our country. So we are still in the process of evolving this phase of unlockdown. Let's wait and see. I'm very optimistic, as you are. Major production factories have now come back, and now the production is also, and demand is also coming back. Absolutely. Let's see the festive season, how it rolls out, and the winter. So I'm waiting for this first phase where the production is being brought back, and the festival season, how the Diwali and the Sahara season goes. So we have to see and have a measured response to it. I would rather feel that the response should be measured and also gradual. Otherwise, we still fear a second wave higher than the first wave. And mind you, we are still not even at the peak of the first phase.
Okay.
We must remember this epidemiological fact of COVID evolution in our country. We as a country have not reached the peak of infection in our country. We are still going uphill. So this sheer epidemiological fact can never be neglected. And the kind of vulnerabilities, kind of low infection rates, low exposure rates in number of states in our country, even today, will also determine the response in terms of our response. What happened when state after state was imposing lockdown again? If you remember, certain states were imposing lockdown for 7 days. Some states say 5 days in a month. One day and then 4 days no lockdown, one day four no lockdown. So this inconsistency of response, which is not scientific, will also determine the spread of infection in our country. And production houses suffer because they cannot plan the logistics of production.
Yes, sir.
And the logistics of transport and the raw material supply. In India, we are dependent. South India is dependent, North India, North India is dependent, South India, East is dependent on West in terms of supplies and production. And the capacity of consumption is different. Places where consumption happens is different. Places where production happens are different. So we have to get this logistics working. We in the railways do realize how crucial part the road transport and train transport and shipping. They are so crucial for this pandemic as well.
Yeah, in addition to that, we have to take into consideration the pathogenicity of the virus, because in addition to we are fearless now, because 71% of or more of the cases they are now recovering, but that fear should still, the fear of this virus should still be there in our mind, because a lot of people are suffering from comorbidities or they are elderly. And how the action will take in this in these cases, the severity of the this particular virus in this particular individual with comorbidity or elderly, how it will take the shape, that is quite we can't imagine that. And lot of sequelae are there which linger on for weeks, like the persistent fatigue, breathlessness, chest pain, inability, and lot of morbidities, they will remain with the patient. So do we want our workforces to remain with these morbidities, with lung fibrosis and many other sequelae of this virus infection? Instead, though yes, we are social animals and we need to come back to our old norms, but still we need to be careful about this particular virus till the vaccine comes and we are protected from this particular virus, because getting infection, getting immunity after that with the sequelae and morbidity is not a good solution
point well taken. I am not challenging any of these points at all. Whatever Rajiv said, what you are saying is right, but the whole issue is ki when it started, the news was full of only COVID. Today, if you see the news, what I'm saying is ki people are learning to live with COVID. Today, if you see, there is something of COVID there, but there is always, you know, something new coming up, whether it's Sushant Singh Rajput or anything. So the whole importance is going away because people have started to accept it and people have started to learn to live with COVID. As you said, comorbidities. I am in the coma, you know, I'm in this vulnerable age group and vulnerable with all the comorbidities. So I, as a doctor, probably will have that fear, will not go out. The personal things people will do. But generally, I'm talking about the general population with people, whether it is the fear because the recovery rates are really high, because whatever the reasons. What I am seeing is that slowly people have started not giving so much of importance to it. Earlier, if somebody got COVID positive in my building, it would be a big news. Everybody would say, ki usko kya karne ka hai, dekho. Desanitize or sanitize everything and all those things. Today, let us give him whatever support he requires. You know, today, all I'm saying is the human behavior is such that slowly we are moving towards accepting it and going ahead with it.
Yeah, that's right, sir. But still the isolation norms and the containment norms, we have to go by the old norms only. We can't...
Correct. This will go on till the vaccine comes.
Yes.
Dr. Sandeep, there are certain questions in the question box. You can take up.
Dr. Divyangsha wanted to ask some questions, sir.
No, yes.
Dr. Divyangsha.
I think he's not on the panelist list, so I don't know.
No, he's there. He has unmuted. Hello.
I'm audible. I was muted.
Yeah, Dr. Divyangsha.
Just one question, that when we are working, returns from work and the fear is there and all this. But see, the government has put that Arogya Setu app. And the app is give the risk profile based on the four questions in which you answer. Based on that, it decides and the proximity of the near contacts. How to interpret this risk profile given by the Arogya Setu app to determine the fitness of return to work?
Arogya Setu app is a good supportive tool, but this should be used as a supportive tool for decision making. I think for return to work, the crucial factor is the standard treatment protocol that we have. 10 days of no fever, 3 days of 10 days of no symptoms and 3 days of no fever, and then 7 days isolation, and the person's clinical assessment by a qualified health professional, especially focusing on SpO2 measurement after 6 minutes walk. If these criteria are fulfilled, Arogya Setu is supportive, then one is fit to work. So this Arogya Setu cannot be used as the only tool. The two have clinical assessment, adherence to treatment protocol, national clinical protocol. That means 10 days plus 7 days and Arogya Setu together. And always remember, determine SpO2, measure SpO2 after 6 minutes of walk. That will be the crucial factor which will determine the person to be allowed to return to work, and also correlate his normal strenuousness of the work, whether it is very strenuous or less strenuous. For a normal office work, this is okay. But for moderate level of work, if a person has suffered, refrain from giving strenuous, intensive work for at least 6 weeks, because of simple reason, Dr. Sandeep mentioned about it, the fibrosis that happens in the lungs. Let the infection heal, and there should be evidence, sustained evidence, that after 6 minutes walk, SpO2 is maintained to at least 94%. And that should be recorded. Only on this every recording, fitness for work should be certified by a qualified health professional. I think that should satisfy you, Dr. Divyan. Aarogya Setu should be used as supportive.
Yeah, that's very expressive and informative. The challenge is that especially on the KPO, BPO, where they don't have the full-time medical services available, like occupational physicians, where the HR takes a call or safety takes a call, especially in the low-risk, close contact people. The Aarogya Setu app does not differentiate whether you are high risk or low risk. It just only asks whether you are coming to contact with a case or not. And if it's yes, then you are either in the moderate risk or the high risk. And that the employee HR themselves take the decision that yes, you stay home and got yourself quarantined and got yourself tested. Now, how far this is the correct, as that needs to be debated and educated to these people.
I think persistence education to the HR professionals through HSE has to happen, and the government public health facilities and also state health administrations have to support, because in India situation is unique and very different in different places in our country, very diverse. I find many of the doctors are struggling to convince their HR department that the person need not be allowed to work for some time, even for 7 days. They are struggling to convince the administration, but the suffering will be reflected later. A person who has lung fibrosis, you know, the person is going to be decapacitated for long, maybe 6 months. He cannot work, because the moment he works, he gets breathless. Only, in fact, few people are now requiring CPAP and BiPAP machines after even 3 months after recovery. And if you look at them, you will realize this person is really sick. He is not going to be normal. He has no fever, nothing else except breathlessness because of the lung fibrosis.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, welcome.
Dr. Rajkumar wanted to comment.
Yeah. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, thanks to Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain for his excellent presentation. My concern is similar to what Dr. Shanbag and Dr. Gajendra Kumar has said, and it is related to, you have spoken about this teleworking and telemedicine. But given the poor public health infrastructure that has been neglected for years in India, this is going to be a real challenge.
I agree.
In fact, health industry has lagged behind the banking industry or the travel industry.
Yes.
Banking can do all the transactions sitting at home. In travel industry, you can book a hotel sitting from home. What I feel, the time has come for overhauling and organizing this public health system. Even if we go back to normal and the patients, especially they come in the public hospital, you all know there is a great rush. So we have to organize ourselves regarding scheduled appointments, less handling of files, electronic records. I think we have to do a lot of work in this. That means improving the public health infrastructure. What is the present condition, which is not sufficient? We have seen everywhere, even in Mumbai and even in Delhi, we have struggled hard. That is not so well means organized or improved. to fight this COVID. So time has come to improve all this thing. And this is the right focus. It can fast track this thing. This is my opinion.
I agree with you, Dr. Rajkumar. And some substantive steps are already in the pipeline. A few I can share with you at the moment. Do you know that in Central Health Service, the public health cadre consists of only 86 public health specialists in our country, in the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Now, with this pandemic, Government of India has sanctioned 1,200 posts, additional new posts to be created for this public health sub-cadre of the Central Health Service.
That's a good
86 thing. Is the current base, 1,200 posts are sanctioned in addition. First phase, 296 posts and 796 in the second part are going to come up. Second, telemedicine framework was made a statutory legalized framework in our country. This happened due to pandemic. Today, Prime Minister has introduced Health ID and the Digital Health Mission together. And mission means funding, support and rollout all across the country on a fast track mode. And the framework that Government of India has made for the Digital Health Mission is 1,000 days. And this is the 50% mark will be reached in 300 days. So Digital Health Frame Mission along with Health ID can support public health infrastructure strengthening.
That is the need of that. At least it can take off the load, means scheduled appointment.
This will be only one part. The second part is the education. Education in public health, which is still lacking. And it is not preventive social medicine, by the way. Public health education includes number of specialties which have not been taught in our country, whether at the undergraduate level or the postgraduate level. There are no courses available. And there are no institutions available. And that is the reason Public Health Foundation of India came up. Dr. Pingle is attending this. Indian Institute of Public Health. The vision for that was to create a landscape of public health specialists who are rooted in our country and who have global capabilities. But they have Indian roots. But this needs to be rolled out more robustly. They have to fund it very strongly and they have to be supported by statutory regulations very fast. Only then this will happen. In fact, I was waiting for Dr. Shyam Pingle to actually respond Dr. on this.
Dr. Pingle sir has raised his hand. Sir, you can...
Yes. First of all, Dr. Jain, you generally complain because I don't come on video. I did want to, but it has been disabled today. So I hope you'll excuse me. It was an excellent presentation, well researched as always. You had done a lot of work before giving this. It's not just your views, but also your studied research, which is reflecting in whatever you gave
thank
in
you.
Your presentation.
Thank you.
So thank you so much for that. I have three quick questions. First is rather a comment or a question, whichever way you take it. There has been an increasing trend of outsourcing of occupational health services in various organizations, which is leading to trivialization. And you can say there are only nominal occupational health services or just on paper, because people are not being employed on regular roles. And even those who have been engaged on contract, they're changing very quickly, because new batches are always cheaper and old people want increment, so that's happening. So how will COVID affect this trend? Whether it will reverse, whether it will increase further because people are having less money or organizations are having more resource constraints, what will happen and what can we do to reverse it? Because I think that is a very important situation.
Very appropriate question, actually. Yeah, you go on, please. You wanted to say something more.
Yeah, no, the two are different topics. So therefore, you can comment on this first.
Yeah, it is very crucial, actually, to have a permanent, assured occupational health service people who are capable and who know the landscape in which they have to perform, because that is a prerequisite for them to perform effectively. One has to know the organization and its culture. And over that epidemiological tools have to be applied. So what is needed is a long-term handholding by the qualified health professional in any organization, and occupational health services require all the more robust tools for this purpose. Just now I mentioned about what central government has done, creating 1200 posts with the existing 86 posts. These are all permanent posts about public health specialists recruited through Union Public Service Commission who are going to work for more than 30 years in Government of India. Part two will be through state health missions, which will have to be, at the moment, will be contractual. The problem, as you know, in even epidemiologists in state, many of the states are vacant, and whosoever is recruited is recruited on a contract basis. Organizations will keep on struggling on this. I only hope there is some statutory provision is made in the days and years to come where full-time regular employment to a by a qualified professional will be required under the Companies Act, where people with regular capabilities and who wherever capabilities are not there, they're supported by proper education and training in good institutions. Only then their effectiveness shall be realized by the owners. And ultimately, the benefit is visible to only the employers who have the vision, long-term sustainability of their organization. Unfortunately, the insecurity in our economic sphere is reflected in the ownership of organization in our country. That once that changes, if you see in India, wherever the organization which is very robust and sustainable, they are employing full-time qualified professional at good salaries in production companies as well as organizations which are very large base. Organizations which are not having the long-term vision, say about 50 or 100 years vision, they will never employ full-time health professional, leave aside occupational health professional, because they cannot see the benefit of it in terms of their production or in terms of their HR giving more productivity. So that is a challenge. I think Government of India, as well as few of the states in our country, are seized of the matter, and things are changing. And they will change faster, I feel now, after the pandemic.
Dr. Rajiv wants to have some comment on this outsourcing.
Dr. Pingle wanted to say something else.
On outsourcing, Dr. Rajgopal wants to respond.
Let Dr. Rajgopal come in.
Shyam, that's a wonderful question you have raised. And what I want to tell everyone here on the call, especially those of you who are in senior leadership positions and are actually in a decision-making position within your organizations, is that believe in the dictum that you should never waste a crisis. And this crisis has actually shown the organizations the value of what public health qualified people or occupational health professionals can bring to an organization. So what I've done within Unilever is to use this opportunity to tell Unilever that we must move away from this business of outsourcing and giving contracts to outsource people. And when I talk of Unilever, I'm talking globally, whether it is Latin America, North America, or India, or any other part of the world. So we are actually in a big exercise now to see which are the critical places where we will need full-time employees. And we are going in a big manner for people who are qualified in occupational medicine, in public health. In India itself, for instance, we have around 40 part-time medical officers. And we will soon be taking many of these people, or at least the critical roles amongst them, would be converted into full-time, working for the organization in the full-time roles of the organization. And this is going to stay. Because what I observe internationally, benchmarking with other companies also, is that people have suddenly found that, you know, they are being valued by the C-suite, you know, the chairman, the HR people, the supply chain people, because they don't have a clue and they need proper answers. And so therefore, people who are actually going to retire in many of these companies have been asked to stay back for 1 year, for 2 years, or whatever. But that's not a solution. It's not for the old people to stay back. The solution is, how do you get youngsters, groom them, bring them in, so that the leadership pipeline is never drained. So the challenge for all of us is, how do you build the next generation of leaders, the third generation of leaders, and bring them in? And that's what I would urge everybody to do. Use this opportunity, because organizations are scared, and rightly so. Because if you don't have a clue of what you need to do, whether it's the first wave, second wave, or multiple waves, or whether it is going to be entirely another pandemic, we are all facing the twin burden of a pandemic and the huge issue of non-communicable diseases, which is just hitting people. Mental well-being is a huge issue. And therefore, what we actually want to do is to see that, you know, we can generally add value in terms of getting in people. For those of you who would have been with the association for long, you would recollect that maybe around 7 or 8 years back, I actually published a couple of papers in the Indian Medical Journal as well as in AEOHD journal about what is the qualities which we need from, you know, medical officers. And as they transition from a factory medical officer to the head of a global organization, what are the traits which we need? And they're just main traits which I actually look at in terms of employing somebody is that you should be good in clinical medicine, first of all. If you can't diagnose, if you can't help people when they are in need, you are of no use to an organization. I think that's the most important thing. Then comes your ability in terms of occupational risk assessment, in terms of public health, in terms of epidemiology, in terms of ergonomics, in terms of toxicology, in terms of product safety. And we look at it in terms of, do you have a basic level of appreciation or you are having leading edge? When you reach leading edge in terms of public health, occupational medicine and all, you can aspire to be a global leader. Otherwise, when you have a little less knowledge in terms of all this, but you're able to engage with experts, you can be at a regional level. You can run 5-6 countries, big countries. So this is what, you know, we need to do as AEOHD. Can we use this opportunity to really start lobbying, not only in the private sector and public sector, but also in the government, to say that this is the important value addition which we bring. And we have had so many debates, Shanbhag would bear me out, on how does an occupational health physician add value? And we have spoken about it ad nauseum. It could be in the space of personal capacity, in terms of human resource, where you care for people, nurture them when they are having a problem. It could be in terms of legal, all these compensation acts, the aspect of corporate reputation. It could be in terms of financial, where you look at return on investment and you find that every rupee you invest gets back 4 rupees or something. Or it could be in a host of plethora of things. So my passionate appeal to everyone, and including, I don't know whether the IOH president and secretary are here, is that as IOH, as stalwarts who are leading the organization, this is the right time for us to pitch for getting more and more people made permanent. I don't want you to go to the extent of telling that, you know, they will be protected by law, because I don't believe in that. If you are performed, your organization will take care of you. There's no need for protection by law, as like safety people are doing, because many people ask, can we be protected? This is not an employment generating opportunity where you will stay forever and not contribute. Show your worth and the organization will keep you even beyond your normal time frame. So that's just a few comments.
I agree with you, Dr. Rajgopal. There's no doubt the vision that you have laid down for organization. And this kind of organizations, I wish they grow faster than any other organization. Organization which employ qualified individuals, which have dual capacity and capability in terms of clinical sciences and administrative or the epidemiological sciences, in addition to occupational health capabilities. Yes.
Dr. Shanbhag was saying. I just want to add one thing. You know what Raj has said, we always discuss this and we always come to the same conclusion all the time. My only appeal is to the youngsters who are today occupying positions in industry on a contractual basis. Use this opportunity to show your worth. And I'm sure if you show your worth, make yourself indispensable, the company is going to put you on a full-time basis. Please use this opportunity. Don't keep on cribbing. This is corona pandemic has given you an opportunity. Show that, you know, the HR is going to come and ask you advice. Please show your worth today so that you get. And that is the message you can give. Otherwise, you know, you don't get an opportunity. Today you are getting that opportunity. So please show your worth today and get yourself converted into a full-time position. That is worthwhile for people to understand.
Thank you, Dr. Shanbhag and Dr. Rajgopal. In fact, that was my objective in raising this topic, that our young doctors must create value and they also need to demonstrate the value. Absolutely. In their organizations. So then only we'll go ahead, and AEOHD as an organization can support them, and we can create opportunities for them to learn, or we can see that they get benefited by our collective wisdom whenever and wherever it is required appropriately. Thank you so much to both of you. And Dr. Jain, coming back to your presentation, there are two quick questions. As I said, one is, when do you see India overtaking United States and becoming number one in COVID cases? And second question is, when do you see AEOHD conference taking place physically as before?
I think the answers are tougher than the question.
if you don't mind, I will answer this thing. So somebody sent me a joke the other day. That person is asking the doctor with his stethoscope and all that, when do you think this pandemic is going to get over? So he says, I am neither a journalist nor a politician. So don't ask.
Right. Hey, you see, the counter question to that is, will the Olympics happen in Tokyo next year?
Without the spectators.
Without the spectators. No, and US Open, you know, everybody is withdrawing after entering. They are withdrawing.
Jain, you need some lateral thinking for that. It will happen in Tokyo next year. Wherever it happens, we'll call the city as Tokyo.
Absolutely. It may happen in 160 countries. The decentralized Olympics can happen.
That can also happen virtually. No? Everybody runs in his own.
I wish sports should have a new normal also.
Yeah.
Everything depends upon how we behave to the pandemic and how careless we are towards the all the preventive and protective measures which have been there. Like hand washing, and distancing, and masking, and other things. If we are careless, and if we are not maintaining all these norms, then definitely we can't predict when our new conference will occur physically, and when the new waves will emerge because of our careless attitude. That time will tell. And I think Dr. Shiva has any questions.
Yeah.
You are muted.
Again muted. Yeah.
Rajiv, excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Regarding, you were talking about all this, what you have talked, as Shanbag did mention, it is temporary. Now, how long this temporary is going to continue, that depends, but it is temporary. But unfortunately, our country is a country where patience is totally absent. We are all impatient people, which you can see when the lockdown has been eased a bit, people have become impatient. So this lockdown and this COVID will teach us patience. And certain things which are happening today, which is temporary, will become permanent. So it is very, as I always mention, is that people will learn to accept things. Then things will change. So thank you for your excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Kamla Patyal, our Vice President from Delhi branch.
Good afternoon, everyone. Sir, that was a wonderful presentation. Looking forward, looking back, I think we all learned a lot about history and the present scenario as far as COVID is concerned. Sir, I just wanted to know, as we are doing so well in Delhi, Maharashtra, but when I look at Bihar, I'm seeing that there is a lot of chaos out there, a lot of problems. Do you think as far as Bihar, Assam, Arunachal is concerned, will there be any more changes like they have done in Delhi and Maharashtra and all, where private institutions were also allowing COVID patients to be admitted, but Bihar and all, it's not so. Daily, we are seeing there is patients who need ventilator supports and they are not getting it in AIMS. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, of course. I'm able to hear.
I think my battery is getting a little low.
I'm able to understand what you're trying to say.
Yes, sir.
Both Bihar, Arunachal, Assam, three states you mentioned, all are challenging situations.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But Arunachal, I feel, will get to tackle the situation more effectively than Assam and Bihar. And okay. Assam challenge is immense, and that is also compounded by another confounding factor of ensuing elections in November this year. So it's a challenging situation, and it's going to be more challenging as the days go by. And also by the sheer fact that the health institutions on the ground, number of health professionals per 1,000 population, health institutions, whether public or private, the number is also very challenging situation. The qualified professionals are relatively lower. Also, the testing capacity, the spread of testing availability in all the districts is also quite diverse in Bihar. It's a challenging situation, and I feel Government of India is trying to support the Bihar administration to develop it faster, to rise up to the challenge. And I only wish that they come up to not only facing the challenge, but also surmounting the challenge. It's a huge, huge challenge for Bihar.
Yes, sir. Because I
think the Pradesh is showing very good results in terms of testing. So there is a model for Bihar to follow. Uttar Pradesh model, they had similar problems, but they have come up for testing capabilities very effectively and very fast. I feel Bihar can also come up to meet the challenge.
Okay. Actually, those failed to react well in time when the first and second lockdown was in place. Now they are facing the problem.
In addition to that, there is flood situation also.
Because lot of
it's a challenging situation by any yardstick. It's a definitely very highly challenging situation.
Last two comments from Dr. Prasikala.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Jain, for a nice presentation. Regarding the proposed unique health ID and the national ID for doctors under NDHM, what are the advantages of this, and then what is the features for this?
I would like to clarify, health ID is for the entire country, entire citizen of this country, which means digital health records, which means portability of health records, which means access to very robust system of health and disease profile over a period of time, available through the digital health mission robust infrastructure, a national backbone, which is available across health facilities, public and private. It was on paper. It was in the running for last now 4 or 5 years at the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare level. I know this because one of the railway officers is on deputation to Ministry of Health as Joint Secretary, is working in the Ministry of Health, driving this process. But this was not taking shape because of the lack of financial support. But since Prime Minister has announced it today from Red Fort, that financial support would be available. So that will take shape faster.
Is there any national ID for doctors also? There's a proposal.
That is also in the pipeline by the new reformed National Medical Commission. If you know, the Medical Council of India has been superseded, and the Board of Governors is presently working as a temporary phase. In the days and months to come, a new National Medical Commission, of which President and other office bearers have been already appointed, that one of the responsibility is to have that ID for health, for real time health ID for all the qualified health professionals. That is also in the pipeline.
That is national. It's not the. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So the last comment from Dr. Tyagaraj, sir.
Sir, good evening, Dr. Jain, good evening. Sir.
Good evening.
Your facts, figures, and practical knowledge of your lecture is very remarkable. I wanted to ask you, what about these basics and beyond basics of the society, and all the roles of the occupation physician and the role of the general practitioners regarding this COVID? And second thing is, some of the things like the patient, already Dr. Sandeep Sharma has mentioned, a person who is having a fibrosis, he cannot be made fit because his lung capacity will come to a very minimal, and at least he has to be under the pulmonologist for the long time. It is nothing but CPOD, and this one, it is a very, very, very pathetic. And some of the cases that which we see that fever cases, which are positive cases, can be made fit to the factory or anything after 2 or 3 weeks. But cases of fibrosis, cases of lung fibrosis, cases of some of the this one, is it possible to fit into the factory? And second thing is, what is the occupational physician basics knowledge, sir? Can you will you please highlight it?
Yes, very relevant question and very important questions. Actually, I feel during the pandemic, two specialties have come in the limelight. One is epidemiology, and the second is pulmonologists. If you look at the number of qualified epidemiologists available in our country, it's very, very few. The need is huge. Second, pulmonology as a specialty was an unpopular specialty even amongst internal medicine people and even amongst pediatricians. Pulmonology is a very important branch and specialty in the days and years to come, and it is very relevant to occupational health practice in organizations. And the chronic incapacitation of individuals is going to be rolled out in the months and years to come. As the people who were earlier productive, post-COVID, they may not be that productive for active, moderate to intensive work in production houses. And this is going to be an unstable, unpredictable phase. Most of the pulmonologist friend that I have, they are saying, the response is very erratic. Sometimes they suffer, they get SpO2 very low levels just by walking. And sometimes they start working for 5-6 days and then they start suddenly deteriorating. So this is going to be a very tough task for occupational health physicians. That's why I'm requesting all occupational health physicians in practice in organizations, especially production houses, have pulse oximeter recording serially done after 6 minutes walk and get it recorded on a regular basis, at least once in fortnight for all COVID patients and once in a month for all non-COVID workers. Just record, the serial record itself will be very, very helpful.
Yeah,
we have been in discussion for more than 2 hours now, and there is one another program lined up with our Jamnagar IUH branch at 4:30 p.m. So, Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain, sir, this was a very enthralling presentation and on this Independence Day. And we all thank you very much for remembering all the unsung heroes of the independence and the corona warriors who are fighting this corona battle. And we do not know how long this battle will continue. That freedom from COVID, it will take a long time, and everything depends upon our behavior. And we are now predicting the virus behavior, but our behavior, we still need to streamline so that it is appropriate and it doesn't cause any further rise in the number of COVID cases. And lot of learnings from our other seniors from IUH also, who have given a lot of insight that we have to believe in the dictum that never waste the crisis. So we as occupational physician, the learnings from Dr. Rajiv Kumar Jain and from our seniors, we need to demonstrate our worth in our respective industries, and accordingly we have to create our place. And that was a great learning to them, that whosoever are in contractual basis, they should work and hard and show their word to the management so that they can be put on permanent roles of the corporation or the industry in which they are working. So a lot of recommendation has been given, sir, and all these things they will definitely remember, the tips for remote working, the tips for teleworking, and all the concluding remarks like good health cover, improved testing, digital health framework mission, which have been launched by our Prime Minister of India. All these things will finally shape how we will come out of the COVID-19 situation. And I thank you all very much for participating. And thank you, Dr. Rajiv sir, again, for giving your enthralling presentation and 2 hours discussion with all the participants. I thank you, all the participants. And before we conclude, let us once again rise to the national anthem and pay our tribute to the Corona warriors.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya He Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladhitaranga Tava Shubha Name Jage तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे